Hello, this is Scott Horton. I will be doing the presentation today. So we've now launched the live webinar room and attendees will start joining. Hopefully as you're joining, you can hear me and you can see the cover slide for the presentation today, covered COVID-19 after 18 months. We're scheduled to get started in a few minutes, so we'll just sit tight and let everyone log in. Everyone seems to be able to join, or at least a good number of people are filling up the room. So we will plan to get started in just a couple of minutes once everyone has had a chance to enter. I'll say this again when we get started, but there will be slides that I will be referencing during the presentation. Those will be available to everyone after the presentation or at the end of the presentation. So for those who are wondering, as you're getting settled, that will be the case. We'll also do question and answer at the end, and you can use the chat feature to type in your questions for that. Again, I will address all this right when we get officially started, but for those who are joining, I just wanted to mention this as you are getting ready for the presentation. We do have a large number of people registered for the webinar, so I'm just going to allow another couple of minutes to give everyone a chance to get logged in. And then we will go ahead and get started. The plan for these is normally to last approximately an hour, and I suspect that will be the case, but I do stay on to answer any questions and the question and answer at the end, as long as that takes. Within reason, but we've never had any problem getting all those questions addressed. Again, I'm Scott Horton. I'm going to be giving today's presentation, and we are going to get started in just a minute. I just want to make sure everyone who is trying to log in right now on time has a chance to do that. Thank you all for joining us for today's webinar, COVID-19 after 18 months. I am Scott Horton. I am the founder and attorney with Horton Law PLLC in Orchard Park, New York, just outside of Buffalo for any who are in other parts of the state and not familiar with the area. My practice encompasses labor and employment law throughout New York State primarily. And when I started preparing to do this webinar and announced the webinar and scheduled it and all of that, I did so knowing that it wasn't really clear what exactly I would be able to address in the webinar, because there are several items that were breaking and yet to be determined. And that remains the case as we sit here today. But I will go over both what we do know, what is in place, and some of the items that we are waiting to learn more about. Just some of the preliminaries. Again, hopefully you can hear me and see the slide for the cover of the presentation. The slides that I'll be using throughout the presentation will be available. You can click on a link to access those at the end of the presentation. Otherwise, as long as you're registered for the webinar, then you will get an email sometime tomorrow with the slides available there as well. So you don't have to stay to the end to get access to the slides. We will do question and answer through the chat function, so you can type in your questions. Typically, I'll try to save that for the end just so we can get through the material in a timely manner for those who need to get going towards the end of about an hour, but I will always stay and answer all the questions that I can at the end. If I do happen to see a question at a point where I can just address it throughout the presentation, I will do that. The most important thing is to get in your question when you think of it so that you don't forget to ask it later and we won't have any trouble circling back and addressing it later on. Okay, with all that being said, again, this is a legal update for New York employers. So there is a New York specific lien. There are some federal issues that we will be addressing if you have as few as one employee that you're somehow responsible for in New York State, then there's going to be information that will be relevant to you at the state level. If you don't have any New York employees, then some of this information will not directly pertain to your circumstances, but we are going to give some updates on the federal level that would apply no matter where your organization is in the United States. No matter where you are likely getting bombarded from various directions, things coming from the left, from the right, from the top, from the bottom, from out of the blue, from this government agency, from the state level, from the federal government, and it is and has been for 18 plus months now, a nearly never-ending task to try to determine what guidance, parameters, restrictions, requirements, legal obligations, etc., are in effect for your particular business, company, organization, whatever it might be. So that continues, unfortunately, all this time later after the launch of the pandemic. Some of the laws we are going to mention today actually took effect as early as March and April of 2020. And when those laws were put into place, certainly it was not expected that we would still be in this situation and that those laws would still be relevant in September of 2021. But unfortunately, they are. One of the issues, this is obviously New York specific, that has had developments this month is the component of the Health and Essential Rights Act, or the HERO Act, that pertains to airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plans. The HERO Act itself was initially signed by Governor Cuomo in May of 2021. It was then amended about a month later in June and took effect with respect to both airborne infectious disease exposure plan requirements and workplace safety committee requirements at various times throughout this year. In fact, the workplace safety committee components of the HERO Act are not in effect yet. We will touch on that because it is somewhat relevant to the COVID crisis at this point. But the most recent development pertains to those infectious disease plans that New York employers are required to have as a result of the HERO Act. This applies to private businesses in New York, for-profit and not-for-profit. It does not apply directly to public employers. So school districts, towns, cities, villages, counties, et cetera, are not subject to the HERO Act per se. They have different obligations to be prepared for dealing with potential disease and pandemic issues. The one other carve out, even within the scope of private businesses in New York, is that the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plan component of the law does not apply to employers who are subject to OSHA regulations regarding COVID-19. At the moment, this includes certain healthcare employers and organizations and their employees. So hospitals in particular are pretty clearly covered by federal regulations at this point in time, emergency regulations, which is an issue that will come up again in this presentation. So for that reason, if you are subject to that OSHA guidance or technically regulation, then you're not also obligated to be following the HERO Act. Unfortunately, it's not very easy to make a clear distinction between which healthcare providers, so to speak, or organizations are subject to the OSHA regulations. OSHA itself has a very complicated flow chart that you have to work your way through. And because that probably doesn't affect most of the employers who are represented in this webinar, I'm not going into too much more detail on that. But that is a carve out and a potentially relevant carve out for all of you, whether you're in healthcare or not, which I will get back to a little bit later in the presentation. So specifically, the Airborne Infectious Disease Exposure Prevention Statute is now Labor Law Section 218-B. This required that all employers, again, private employers of any size, so as few as one employee, had to adopt a plan by August 5th. This law was not intended to be specific to COVID-19. It certainly resulted from the COVID pandemic, but the law, when it was passed by the legislature, was intended to be a forward-looking law to make sure that employers were prepared in advance for the possibility of future disease outbreaks. So when you had to adopt a plan by August 5th, it was a generic plan. So it would be available to go in place if the Commissioner of Health at some point in the future designated existing infectious disease as creating a sufficient public health risk to implement these plans and the obligations it would then pose in the workplace. However, as frankly I predicted in some of the previous webinars I gave on the HERO Act, it certainly looked like COVID-19 may well be shaping up to be the first such public health risk that would trigger activation of these plans. And the governor, now Governor Kathy Hochul, on Labor Day a couple of weeks ago, announced that these plans were being activated with the designation. Frankly, it's not clear whether the Commissioner of Health was planning to make such a designation when the governor announced it on Labor Day. And technically, it was the Commissioner of Health who had to make the designation, not the governor. That being said, after the announcement, there was a declaration by the Commissioner of Health to invoke the Airborne Infectious Disease Exposure Prevention plans to require those to be activated by all employers. The Commissioner of Health designation was technically in effect from Labor Day through September 30th. So it's still in effect now. The initial deadline is a week away. However, frankly, it is subject to extension and seems likely to be extended. Yeah. And the latest development on this whole situation is that the governor announced a couple hours ago that the Commissioner of Health has put in his resignation and that has been accepted, except that he will stay on for a transition period until a new Commissioner of Health is in place. I think, if anything, that's only further reason to believe that this designation is not going to actually expire September 30th, but one way or the other will be extended, whether by the current Commissioner of Health or by the next Commissioner of Health, depending on how quickly that transition may occur. So again, as of September 6th, all plans were expected to be activated. There's no specific time frame for how quickly that has to happen. There are a few things that that requires all employers to do. That requires private employers to review their plans, again, especially under the theory that the plans were all written to be generic and not specific to COVID-19. The only advantage that we have in that regard is they were frankly written based on COVID-19 anyway, because that was the only recent example we had that we were dealing with. So there are probably not as many modifications that would be required if this had been years down the road and activation was triggered by some entirely new disease. But you're supposed to review the plan, update it as necessary, and then activate the plan. In activating the plan, whether you've revised it or not, it appears that employers are expected to provide the plan in writing to employees again. Based on the timing, employers had until basically right before this designation occurred to provide plans to their employees in the first place. But arguably, even if you had already done that in October or the beginning of September, upon activation, there's probably a new requirement to redistribute the plan in writing to your employees. The plan also has to be in your employee handbook if you have one and posted conspicuously in work sites. Those obligations are probably easy enough for people who are paying attention and know that they need to do this. The slightly more taxing requirement, I guess, is that there's an obligation to conduct a verbal review of the infectious disease standard, employer policies, and employee rights under labor law section 218B with all employees. So whether employers were actually reviewing these plans when they got them out in the first place, there is more clearly now an obligation to do it upon activation of the plan. The Department of Labor hasn't given very much guidance on this. They have just indicated that, you know, you need to do it in a way that's appropriate, be it in person or by video conference or audio conference or something like that. But you do need to somehow explain the infectious disease standard, which is the sort of template list from the Department of Labor of what has to be in your plan itself. So arguably, if you review the plan, you've reviewed the infectious disease standard, but this is what is specifically required to be reviewed. You have to review employer policies. There's nothing further specifying what these employer policies include. Does it just include your exposure plan, or does it include any other somehow relevant health and safety policies that you might have? There's really no guidance on that at this point. I don't know that you need to take a particularly expansive view on that, but at the very least, you obviously need to be addressing your plan. And the law clearly requires that this review include addressing employee rights under the law itself, this 218B. I don't think that is an extensive obligation in the sense that you don't have to sit there and read the entire statute to your employees, but there are protections in the statute against retaliation for making claims of violations of the plan itself, or employees have the right to notify their employer that they feel that the conditions are unsafe. And then if they have given that notice, they have the right not to be disciplined for refusing to work under the unsafe conditions. So there are a few legal rights that employees specifically have under the law that presumably need to be reviewed with employees as part of this basically training obligation. The other component of the HERO Act is the Workplace Safety Committee statute. This is a separate provision of the labor law section 27D. It applies again to private employers, except there's a slightly higher bar here because it requires that your organization have at least 10 employees in New York. So this is a potential carve out for non-New York based companies that just happen to have a few employees in New York or small New York companies. The other provision and requirement to have the safety plan applies to all employers with as few as one employee in New York. The workplace safety committee requirements have a 10 employee threshold. Most importantly, what this law does is it says that covered employers must permit employees to establish and administer a joint labor management workplace safety committee. I discussed that in previous webinars and frankly expect to be discussing it in more detail, what that might mean in particular circumstances. With the law not taking effect now until November 1st of this year, which is not that far away, 5 or 6 weeks from the date of this webinar, but we really don't have a lot of answers that we're going to need to implement this law. And we will be getting some of those from the Department of Labor. Hopefully we get enough answers to make it meaningful. What the law clarifies is that once established, these workplace safety committees can do these things, which includes review any policy put in place in the workplace required by the New York labor law relating to occupational safety and health, and provide feedback to such policy in a manner consistent with any provision of law. The labor law certainly requires the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plan. So it certainly seems logical that that is the type of document that the Workplace Safety Committee will have some right to review and provide feedback on. One of the unanswered questions is whether the Workplace Safety Committee's rights will mean that employers will have to revisit the plan that they've already adopted, or is it okay that it's already adopted, or does the committee just have the right to read the plan and put in feedback, but then the employer can do or say whatever it wants or doesn't want? Of course, if it does that, it may do so in some sense to its peril by having been advised of certain concerns and not acting on them. So really, that's the main tie-in at this point for the workplace safety committees. Once they come into play, assuming the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plans are still active, that is likely going to create a new wrinkle in how those plans are administered, or at least what they require in the first place. It's beyond the scope of this webinar to talk about all the details and aspects of the plan requirements. I did a webinar at the end of July on that topic. And if you didn't watch that and want access to that information, you can reach out. You can also find it on the firm website. The latest on this HERO Act and the two different components is that the Department of Labor recently this month did issue a frequently asked question document pretty soon after the designation, although it's not clear whether they did it in response to the designation or were just planning to do it anyway, maybe hurried up a little bit by the designation. But for the most part, the frequently asked question document doesn't provide much relevant elaboration, especially with respect to the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plan obligation. I mean, it does clarify that, yes, you have to do it. Yes, you have to post it. Yes, you have to review it with your employees when activated and things like that. But most of those issues were already pretty clear. It does introduce one clarification potentially on the Workplace Safety Committee requirement. It does indicate that covered employers will be required to establish workplace safety committees. The law itself says that covered employers have to permit employees to form these committees. It didn't arguably it didn't anyway, say that every employer had to have a workplace safety committee, the Department of Labor guidance could be read to suggest that every employer with at least 10 employees is going to have a workplace safety committee as a minimum requirement for compliance. The FAQ document itself confirms that regulations are forthcoming, presumably to address both the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plan requirements, although a lot of that guidance is already out, not entirely helpful, but available. So more likely the major developments will be with regard to the Workplace Safety Committee, again, with that component of the law coming into effect November 1st. Without guidance from the Department of Labor, it's going to be frankly impossible to implement that for many workplaces. There are complexities there as to who can join the Workplace Safety Committee and how that happens and what happens if there are multiple unions or unions and non-union, non-supervisory employees, who determines who's on the committee and how that's represented and overlap with bargaining obligation. I mean, there are a lot of potential issues. In some workplaces, it won't be so complicated, but in many others, especially larger companies and with multiple work sites, there could be a lot of complexity. And again, we don't really know the full extent of their authority at this point and what happens if the employer doesn't heed feedback from the committee. And do they have to revisit old policies and procedures? Do they have to revisit the safety plan under the HERO Act that's just been activated? Obviously, this could create additional administrative obstacles to getting these types of issues addressed. If you want to get the latest on what the Department of Labor has to say about the HERO Act, you can go to the Department of Labor's website. Easiest thing to do might just be to Google New York HERO Act, and it should be the first thing that comes up. They haven't been quick to update. Even when the designation from the Commissioner of Health came out, it took a couple of days before they acknowledged that on this website. But you can find the FAQs there, along with all the model safety plans and the standards and some additional information that they might be producing in the future is likely to be posted there as well. All right, so that is the major New York State development of general applicability to a large number of employers. There are some major developments coming or in place now from the federal government as well. The president recently launched his COVID action plan, which is not limited to workplaces. It also addresses things like entertainment venues and people going to those, whether they're vaccinated or not. But these are the four employee-employer components of this plan. And some of them have more or less impact potentially in New York than others. The broadest component of the plan, and one that has certainly been well publicized since President Biden made the announcement, is that all employers with 100 or more employees must require vaccination or weekly testing. So it's not an absolute vaccination mandate. There is the option to test weekly. And assuming you test negatively every week, you could continue to work. We're going to talk about this more. This is not in place yet. Formally, what the president has indicated he's doing is having OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, issue an emergency temporary standard to impose this requirement. And there are questions as to whether that's possible legally and what it will look like. And we will talk about that in a little more detail. The next component is a mandatory vaccination requirement for healthcare workers. This is not as critical for the most part in New York because the state has already imposed a mandatory vaccination requirement for healthcare workers, which will require against especially nursing home and hospital workers. It doesn't apply all the way down to most private medical offices and practices, but the state will require starting Monday that to work in covered healthcare facilities, such as hospitals, all employees have to have received at least one shot of the vaccination. So if it's a two-shot vaccination, then they have to at least have the first shot by Monday. If they do not, then from the state standpoint, it's pretty clear that they can lose their job. I don't want to spend too much time on this because most of you are not working for these healthcare workers, but I think it's relevant as general knowledge for a couple of different reasons. But this does mean that there are a number, hundreds, if not thousands, of employees in hospitals and nursing homes and other facilities across New York State who will no longer be able to work by Tuesday of next week because they have not received the first shot of their vaccine. And frankly, by that point, it's because they have no intention of doing so. The law does include an exception for people who cannot receive the vaccine related to medical issues. So that would be a disability accommodation. It does not currently include an exception based on religious beliefs. An original version of the New York State requirement did have a religious exemption. The federal court or a federal court in New York has imposed a temporary restraining order on the law, basically saying that healthcare employers have to recognize a religious exemption. Well, that might be going so far too far. It's kind of weird how it works, but basically hospitals have to at least engage in the reasonable accommodation analysis for healthcare workers who claim that they have a religious reason for not getting vaccinated. That doesn't necessarily mean that the employer can't ultimately conclude that it's not a reasonable accommodation to keep that person employed. So that's an interesting scenario developing. But the reason I said it's of general interest, even if you're not in that industry, is frankly, come next week, there's going to be a lot of hospitals who are down in numbers in their workforce where there were already staffing issues. So as a general issue, the governor today was talking about how they might be finding ways to change visa requirements to get foreign healthcare workers, presumably who are vaccinated, into New York to fill these vacancies in the system. She referenced the Philippines and Ireland specifically. I'm not sure that those were, you know, by any means the only places that she was hoping people would come to New York to work from, but that is kind of the status of that issue generally. And the accommodation for disability and religious beliefs issue is one that we will likely face in other vaccination mandates, including the one that would apply to all employers with 100 plus employees. So that's another reason why I wanted to mention that. There is also, as part of the president's action plan, a requirement that federal workers and contractors get vaccinated. I don't think anyone in this webinar is probably representing a federal agency directly or works with a federal agency directly, but some of you probably are working with federal contractors. And I'm going to go into more detail on the status of that vaccination requirement in a moment. The final component of the president's action plan that, again, is specifically directed at employees is a supposed requirement that employers will have to provide paid time off to employees to get vaccinated. This is again something that is supposedly going to be implemented through OSHA. It's It's again questionable whether OSHA has that type of legal authority, but regardless, for our purposes, it's not as much of an issue because New York already has a state law requiring employers to pay employees to get vaccinated. It is possible that the federal requirement could somehow be broader than the state requirement. They may be allowed more time off. They may be given time to recuperate after receiving a shot or something like that that New York doesn't have. But on its face, that seems like a less pressing issue for New York employers and employees than a couple of the other items above. Turning to federal contractors, the president did issue an executive order, as presidents generally have the right to do, that applies to most federal contractors. It does not apply to grantees. So if you have a U.S. Government grant and no contracts, then this doesn't apply. But if you have contracts with the federal government, you should at least look into this further, whether it may apply. The way this works, though, is the executive order doesn't just automatically impose a requirement. It basically directs that new contracts contain languages. So really, it's contractual language that addresses this vaccine issue. So to be subject to these requirements, you will have to have a new federal contract or an extension, renewal, or exercise of an option under a pre-existing contract that takes effect on or after October 15th of this year. What exactly the contract provision is going to require, what obligation it's going to impose on the contractor, is still to be determined. The president has established this Safer Federal Workforce Task Force that has the authority to set parameters for federal government employees as well as these contractors. They're supposed to be proposing the contract language by tomorrow, September 24th. They do have some initial guidance out that applies to federal contractors. Really, the guidance is directed more at federal agencies and how they deal with their contractors. Like if you're a contractor that actually has to go on site at a federal on federal property or federal workplaces, what the agency should be expecting of its contractors regarding vaccination or testing status. But if you are a federal contractor in some way, shape, or form, certainly by the time you do anything that changes on October 15th, a new contract or an extension or renewal, you want to make sure you're paying attention to what's in those contracts in this regard. And we expect there'll be more guidance very soon as tomorrow, to give you better heads up on what that's likely to impose. Now, before I really get into this 100 or more employee obligation, I just wanted to quickly ask the question of how many of you are in an organization that has 100 or more employees. So I'm going to put this up. You should have the ability to click whether your organization has or doesn't have 100 employees. And then there's a not sure category that would include the scenario where it depends on how it's counted, because I know that's a question some are raising. Okay, so the results we're getting in, the majority of you, as I would expect, are with organizations that have over 100 employees, but we got about a quarter who are in smaller businesses. And then I'm looking at 16% right now. Well, just moved up. So 15 to 20%, let's say, of you are in organizations where maybe you're close, or it's going to depend on how it gets counted as to whether you'll be subject to this potential 100 or more employee vaccination or testing requirement. Okay, so this is from the White House's COVID action plan. says the Department of Labor's Occupational Safety and Health Administration is developing a rule that will require all employers with 100 or more employees to ensure their workforce is fully vaccinated, or require any workers who remain unvaccinated to produce a negative test result on at least a weekly basis before coming to work. OSHA will issue an emergency temporary standard, ETS, to implement this requirement. This requirement will impact over 80 million workers in private sector businesses with 100 or more employees. This is consistent with what the president said in his press conference. It is at this point still really the only information we have on this potential requirement, because as of now, as far as I know, OSHA has not issued its proposed rule or its emergency temporary standard, if you will, on this topic. What does that mean? So what is the ETA on the ETS? I've seen estimates that speculate it would take 30 to 60 days from the time the president announced it a little earlier this month. If it takes that long, we could be looking at October or November before such a rule is out there. They could theoretically do it today, tomorrow, anytime. The other question, I intentionally put a bunch of acronyms, I guess they're called, on this slide. Would such a rule be DOA or dead on arrival? There is a fairly strong argument to be made that OSHA doesn't have the authority to impose this type of requirement. They do have the rule out there for healthcare that is not requiring vaccination per se at this point, although the state is separately doing that. But OSHA has the obligation and the right to establish workplace standards, but that's not an absolute authority. So at some point, OSHA exceeds its authority. I saw a little bit of research that said virtually every time OSHA has imposed an emergency temporary standard, it hasn't held up in court. I forget the numbers, but it's something like 6 out of 8 times it was struck down by the court. And the other 2 times, I think basically it became obsolete before the court ever got around to ruling on it. So, and I didn't do that analysis myself, and I can't vouch for its accuracy, but it seemed plausible. The source I was reading, that these emergency temporary efforts by OSHA are not likely to be very effective. And this certainly seems problematic in a couple of respects. One is the focus on employers with 100 or more employees. Usually OSHA provides standards by industry type or workplace conditions. I have on the slide here this picture of some folks presumably inspecting safety conditions at a factory. So there's certain safety requirements and factory settings that obviously are different from requirements and office spaces where the standards are generally less restrictive. But so the notion of applying it across the board to all private workplaces with 100 or more people is unusual from OSHA. On the other hand, maybe there's an argument that the nature of transmission of this disease makes it more relevant where there's more people in place. That begs the question that some people have already asked in the chat, as to how do we count the 100 or more people. There might be a plausible argument that it really only makes sense if it's 100 or more people in the same work site. If you have 50 work sites somehow throughout the state with no more than 2 or 3 people in each, then should that obligation really apply to you? If, again, it's not even a New York specific requirement, so you could have those work sites scattered all across the country and not have more than a few employees in any state. People might be working from home. What if 100% of your employees work from home, or 100% less a few? Do those few still have to be vaccinated or test regularly? Again, we don't have this rule from OSHA yet. So we don't know all of the answers to these questions, and the answers to these questions potentially will affect whether a court would uphold the standard. I did see some evidence that there's already litigation blocking the rule, even though the rule's not out. So that obviously no rulings by any courts yet, but preemptive litigation where lawsuits have been filed to be ready for when the rule itself comes out. So obviously there's going to be challenges. This is an interesting scenario. There's a lot of speculation since the time of the president's announcement that the rule itself was less the important factor and just more that the president announced he was putting this rule out there as a method of giving businesses cover to impose a vaccine mandate or a testing mandate on its workforce. So there is that argument that the legal merits of the potential OSHA rule are less important than just sort of the public impact of the statement from the president and the possible efforts by OSHA. I mean, certainly when the standard comes out, it's going to be dangerous for any covered employer to not impose this requirement unless and until a court actually issues a restraining order or an injunction on its enforcement. So those are interesting questions that we will have to answer later when we see the rule. Now let's go back to New York specifically, because if you remember when I was talking about the Airborne Infectious Disease Exposure Prevention Plan, I said that the healthcare industry is not currently subject to that, even in New York, because it is subject to an existing emergency temporary standard from OSHA. I'm fairly confident there's a lot, there are lawsuits out there trying to invalidate that emergency temporary standard as well, but at least it is focused on an industry and seems to be tailored specifically to the concerns of that industry, so maybe more likely to stand. Regardless, if there is now an OSHA emergency temporary standard requiring COVID vaccination or weekly testing for employees in all workplace or all employer with in all workplaces where the employer has 100 or more employees, then at that point in time, there seems to be a pretty good argument in my mind that the Airborne Infectious Disease Exposure Prevention Plan requirements no longer apply to those employers. So I suspect if and when we get something from OSHA, the Department of Labor will be pressured to make a statement to clarify that, as they've been pretty clear on the healthcare issue. But that is a potential New York specific side effect of a future OSHA emergency temporary standard that I doubt the president is paying any attention to. I suspect OSHA isn't going to be very worried about it, but could become very relevant for New York companies. So what else do we have going on in New York State at this point? As I mentioned, we do have the mandatory vaccination for healthcare employees that is basically taking effect Monday, but practically next week anyway. The schools also have requirements of weekly testing, at least for unvaccinated employees. So it's not just teachers or people who are in classrooms. It's, you know, custodians, cafeteria workers, administrators, anyone working in schools has to be tested weekly unless they're vaccinated. They can basically opt out by showing they're vaccinated. So that seems similar to what President Biden has proposed for private employers with 100 or more employees. I should mention that OSHA directly only covers private workplaces. There are New York is one of the states that has adopted a safety plan based on OSHA. So they could adopt the OSHA standard to be applicable to public employees in New York, but it would be a little bit unclear whether and how that will work until the rule actually comes out and we hear from the state. So I just wanted to back up and pick up on that. At this stage, we know there's litigation underway, as I already alluded to, for the healthcare employees. I suspect there's going to be litigation, if there isn't already, related to school employees. That weekly testing requirement is theoretically already in effect, but we're early enough in the school year where I'm not sure how many schools have actually been put in a position to confront an employee who hasn't completed the weekly testing, but we're getting there probably by next week. Districts will have to be dealing with those issues. So the litigation is either underway or growing in those areas and will continue to proliferate with regard to any and all of these mandates, regulations, and requirements, for better or worse. The one other Sorry, I just needed to get a sip of water there. The one other issue I wanted to give the update on is the leave issue. What rights do employees have to be paid if they are out of work due to COVID-19? In New York, we have had since about the very beginning a quarantine leave law. It applies to all New York public and private employers of any size, and therefore all employees in the state. It is specifically limited to employees who are unable to work because they are quarantined or isolated. So this law does not directly apply in the case of a child who has to stay home because they're quarantined. If the parent is your employee and they haven't, for whatever reason, been required to quarantine, for example, if they're vaccinated, then they're not entitled to leave under this law. But if they are directly subject to a quarantine or isolation order, this law is still out there. It requires paid leave in a lot of cases. It's based on the size of the business, but anybody with 100 or more employees has to give 14 days of paid leave. The smallest employers only have to give 5 days and potentially unpaid. And then the middle category of businesses would have to give 5 days of paid leave subject to employees being eligible to get disability benefits or paid family leave benefits to compensate them for lost wages for additional days that they have to be out of work. So this is not the normal disability or paid family leave benefit, but it's through those insurance programs. But it would provide generally full wage replacement rather than only the partial replacement, but only, again, in the case of the employee who is personally subject to a quarantine or isolation order by operation of this New York State quarantine leave law. On top of all of that, if you did have an employee who had to stay home to take care of a child who's been quarantined or isolated, they would potentially be eligible for paid family leave on that basis, but it wouldn't be the enhanced paid family leave. It would just be the standard paid family leave, which is not full wage replacement. There's a comment, yes, this is in addition to any company granted leave, so you can't count this against the sick leave that you're now required to have in New York State or any other PTO. This is separate and apart from that. On top of it, the further clarification that we received earlier this year, much earlier this year now, but still out there, is that of course, nobody expected this to last so long, and nobody expected that people would have to quarantine multiple times, really, or at least if anybody thought of it back in March, they didn't bother to put it in March of 2020, that is, they didn't bother to put it in the law. So the Department of Labor has come up with its own interpretation that frankly has no basis in the law. They just made it up, that says that any individual employee can take up to three such leaves, but the second and third would have to be based on a positive test. So you don't have to test positive to be subject to a quarantine or isolation order. And if it's your first time, you're eligible for this quarantine leave. But by the time you are needing to be quarantined or isolated a second or third time, you can still get the paid leave up to whatever the max is based on the size of the employer, but you have to have a positive test to get that the second or third time. Obviously, if you don't have a positive test, you may be able to use sick leave or PTO or something like that in those scenarios, but you don't get the extra quarantine leave on top of it more than once unless you test positive. The last note on this is basically the same day, I believe, as this New York State quarantine leave law took effect, the federal government passed its Family First Coronavirus Response Act last year, which provided certain paid leave, again, basically 2 weeks paid leave in most cases, and there were some additional FMLA circumstances beyond just the employee themselves being quarantined or isolated or sick, etc. That law ended last year, but remained optional into 2021, so that if employers wanted to pay their employees for leave that qualified under what had been the law, they could still receive tax credits to reimburse the company for paying the employee for those leaves. If anybody is doing that, just note that that optional program and the tax credit eligibility now ends at the end of this month, so a week from today. All right, so I'm going to get to questions now. If you have any questions, go ahead and start typing those in. I know we already have something. Normally at this point in the presentation, I would wrap up with some sort of best practices or do's and don'ts or what I think is going to happen next. But frankly, staring at all of this and trying to figure out what needed to be addressed and the status of everything, the best conclusion I can offer here is at this point, the only certainty is uncertainty on this. And I guess because I'm a lawyer, I went on to add that the only certainty is uncertainty and litigation. So all of this is being attacked from various sides and various interests, and nobody can be certain on how the legal process is going to work. The best we can do is tell you what's in writing and how we read it, but it's all new and untested. So it's a continued strain on everyone. Obviously, nobody wanted this to last this long. The vaccination issue seems to be the leading one from the government entities, at least for New York, and the federal government, the governor's office and the White House are both focused on vaccination, basically at all costs. Not making any sort of value judgment on that one way or the other than to make that observation that the focus is clearly on vaccination. They clearly want everyone to be vaccinated. Governor Hochul's statements today in her press conference were pretty clear that she doesn't feel sorry for any healthcare workers who don't get vaccinated. That is the policy in this state from the governor's mansion, and that is the policy in this country from the White House. And that's what we're going to continue to expect to see to guide probably our regulations and requirements, at least in the first instance, like I said, until somebody challenges it in court, and then we see whether it holds up. Obviously, there's going to be more developments. We know something's going to happen from OSHA. We know we're going to get updates from the Workplace Safety Committee. We will have another webinar, I'm sure, by October on some of those issues. But in the meantime, we will send something out to our email newsletter list as something develops that's worth doing that. But the most frequent updates are put on our LinkedIn page, so you can find Horton Law on LinkedIn. Now I'm going to start taking the questions. So just give me a minute to get organized with looking at the questions. If you have any questions, type them in. Again, I will stay as long as I can. And while I am looking at the questions, I'm now going to post the link for the slides for the webinar so you can grab those too as you like. But remember, you will get an email if you're registered for the webinar tomorrow that also gives you access to that. So you should be getting the link available now. Okay, so I'm going to start answering questions probably more or less in the order that they came in. So again, continue to put your questions in and we'll get to them. One question we have is from a staffing agency. It says that 90% of our employees are based at client sites. When an ETS is issued, meaning from OSHA about the 100 or more employee requirement, I imagine, if we choose to not mandate but allow for weekly testing, do you think there might be any exceptions for staffing agencies? No, I would doubt it. I doubt there'd be any exceptions for anybody. There's no evidence, again, as I kind of alluded to, that either the state or federal executive branches are looking to make exceptions. They're looking to find ways to cover everybody they possibly can. So I wouldn't anticipate exceptions, especially for staffing agencies. I think OSHA would be smart to make industry-specific rules, perhaps standards, that is, but I don't know what they're going to do. So it's hard to guess exactly how that'll work, but I would be very surprised if there was a specific carve out for staffing agencies. In many cases, these new regulations are going above and beyond to lump in contracted and subcontracted workers in addition to employees. So they're looking to cover everybody. They're not looking to give anybody a break. There's a question is, do the airborne infectious disease exposure prevention plans need to be provided to employees who are working remotely? So they have to be provided to all employees, including contractors and other people who come into the work site. You don't have to post them in employees' homes, obviously, but you do have to post them in work sites. And you don't have to necessarily have a plan that covers people who are working remotely, in the sense that you don't have to say what you're going to do in people's private residences or who decide to go work from Starbucks or whatever. But I would say the best practice would be to provide the plan to all employees, regardless of whether they come into the workplace or not. Just you could be clear if you want of who it or like which work sites it covers, but you know, they probably have the right to get the plan in case they do have reason to go into a work site. There was a question about the 100 plus employees. Does that count if you have 100 employees, but they're not all at one location, or you don't have a location with 100 or more employees? Again, there's really no good way to guess at that, except that what I've said a couple of times now, Generally, they're trying to cover everybody they can and not exclude anybody. So I would not be surprised if the standard is based on the employer entity and how many total employees you have rather than where those people are working. But again, I also mentioned that that seems like a potential vulnerability to the enforcement of the standard. So we don't know how creative OSHA will try to get. They're going to balance covering everybody they possibly can with having it upheld in the courts. There's a question about the religious exemptions. What type of accommodation is reasonable? And there's no good guidance on this. Again, it's new. There are certainly employers that are going to take the position that there is no reasonable accommodation that can enable someone who's unvaccinated to come into certain work sites. For example, you know, a hospital might take the position that it doesn't matter what your religious belief is, you're not going to be able to go into a patient room or an operating room if you're not vaccinated. Whether there's another reasonable accommodation could be questioned. Is that person entitled to be on leave or work from home? Different organizations are going to take different approaches on that. And obviously, this really hasn't been tested very clearly in the past under similar circumstances. So it'll just remain to be seen how that gets applied and litigated. It will get litigated. There's going to be lawsuits from people who claim that they didn't receive an accommodation but should have. So again, we know there's going to be litigation. It's hard to predict the outcome. We are a private company and are mandating vaccinations for our employees. Is there any lawful way in reviewing religious exemptions? I'm not 100% sure what that question means. If you want to type something else in to clarify, maybe I already answered it in my response to the other question. But the law, Title VII and the New York Human Rights Law, for example, require employers to consider reasonable accommodations based on employees' religious beliefs in the similar way to considering accommodations for employees based on disabilities. Again, you should engage in the interactive process. Technically, the employee has an obligation to show a sincerely held religious belief. However, that's always worked out to be a pretty light burden. So the clarification is getting right to where I was just going, questioning the legitimate claims. There are websites, and I'm not, I don't want to be accused of picking and choosing religions, but I have seen and have had questions about specific quote unquote religions, some of which aren't even sure that there are religions themselves, who have nonetheless taken the position that I cannot work in a workplace that has unvaccinated people, or on the other end of the spectrum, that I can't be required to get vaccinated myself. The best approach, ideally, in those scenarios is not to try to question the sincerity of the religious belief. That normally doesn't go well for employers, but to focus on whether the accommodation itself would be reasonable, or what accommodation is reasonable, and what would pose an undue hardship on your business. So there is a possibility of challenging the religious belief itself, but the courts and the EEOC and the Division of Human Rights give a lot of deference to what individuals say their religious belief is. Certainly does not have to be a mainstream religious, a mainstream religion, so to speak. The quote unquote religion doesn't even have to necessarily consider itself a religion. The belief itself doesn't even have to be a specific doctrine of the particular religion in question. There are many ways that employees have been able to point to different scriptures that their religion adheres to and come up with their own interpretation. If their own interpretation of their religion differs from the church itself, then that employee could still be found to have a sincerely held religious belief. So again, it's better in most cases to look at the reasonableness of the accommodation and the potential for undue hardship rather than questioning the religious belief. But if you did have enough evidence to show that this person clearly does not actually have a religious belief or a sincerely held faith-based belief or something like that, then legally you could potentially deny the accommodation purely on that basis. All right, here's a question that says, with regard to New York State leaves for employees who need to quarantine, my understanding is that New York paid family leave is not for employees who are sick themselves. I know once the Family First Coronavirus Response Act ends, employee will be eligible to use their sick leave and disability. So it's specific to the category of employers who do not have to give 14 days of paid sick leave or a paid quarantine leave. So if you have under 100 employees and less than, I forget the dollar amount of business, then you may only have to give, for example, 5 days of paid leave or 1 week of paid leave under the New York law. But the law would allow that employees who continue on their quarantine beyond that week, theoretically up to a second week, would then be eligible for enhanced paid family leave or disability benefits. I think they can be eligible for either or in that limited situation, even though New York paid family leave wouldn't normally apply in that situation. So this is a special limited category of applicability for paid family leave and disability leave that ends up providing full wage replacement for that short period of time. So that's what I was alluding to. If you have over 100 employees, then the law doesn't seem to provide for that, because again, when the law was written, the assumption was that nobody would need to quarantine for more than 14 days. That may theoretically still be the case, but certainly someone who is symptomatic could extend out longer. But it's very complicated and depends on the circumstances. So I would just encourage you to double check that. There's a lot of information on the Department of Labor website if you want to go there or work with your insurance carriers for paid family leave, because at that point they do have to apply for those benefits. It's not employer paid. I think I've answered all of the questions that I've seen in chat. So if you have another question, either type it in right now or type something in so that I know you're trying to get your question answered. Otherwise, if I don't see any new activity in the chat in the next minute or so, then I will wrap up. In the meantime, I just want to thank everyone for attending and lasting through to this point. Again, if you have any follow-up questions, my contact information is available on the screen. You will get a follow-up email again with the link to the slides in case you didn't already access those. And do follow us on LinkedIn if you use that platform, because that's probably the best way to get the latest developments before we get a chance to formalize them into a blog post, an article, or into a webinar. That being said, I don't see any new questions. Look for an announcement for our next webinar, which I suspect is going to address some of these issues in more detail, depending on what further guidance we get and when we get it. And just from that, I hope everyone has a nice day and good luck with these ever challenging issues. Hope that we will get through it all eventually.